Even though it has been 21 years since the UN Security Council passed a resolution on women, peace and security, nothing much has changed. Women are disproportionately impacted in conflict, and we know that now more than ever, having been through a war, various insurgencies and riots along the way. Day one of the festival was a discussion with the peace prompters, three young women who have navigated language barriers, racial, ethnic, religious and cultural demarcations beyond gender dimensions to facilitate more proactive engagement in the peace and reconciliation space. Here's author and researcher, Peacebuilding and Reconciliation, Sara Khabir, writer, researcher and activist, Amalini De Sera, and Director for Legal and Advocacy, NCEASL, Yamini Ravindran, on Selinko Life. Let's talk.
Amalini, there is a lot of rhetoric about women being agents of change, there's a lot that women can do, etc., etc. But how does that actually translate to women on the ground? Are they actually given a chance to be a part of the peace and reconciliation process?
Women are some of the most active in engaging with their communities, in creating conversations, in creating safe spaces. So much of what I know and I've learned, I owe to like small women's groups, in whether it's in Puttalam or Jaffna or you know, Batticlo and people like that, who are on the ground, who are not just having conversations about bringing, say, Muslim and Tamil women together, but who are actively supporting war widows or women who are facing domestic violence and things like that. So in terms of that long-term sustainable change, women are doing so much of work, right? And I feel like it's the media circles and the spotlight, but it's always the few of us in Colombo who get talked about. But there's so much of work going on outside.
Sara, you've spoken with both the military side and the LTT side for your book. What were your findings when you, not about the men actually, but the role that women played in this whole, in that scenario?
So one of the main things I think that was interesting to me was in speaking to the women from the LTTE, in how they saw their status as very equal. They said that their training was done very equal. They would carry these RKG, these rocket propeller grenades, which are huge weapons. There was no difference in that sense. But of course, this is talking about violent equality, so it's not the greatest way to be made equal. But with the Sri Lankan military, one of the narratives a lot when I spoke with the men was that, I would have liked to think that it was about safety for women, or, you know, but it wasn't. The conversation was mostly about the fact that women lacked the skills or the sort of ability to work in complicated situations. That was sort of the narrative that came, especially from the Air Force, actually. There was quite a stark difference, but what is really interesting is today, in talking to them, there is a similar gap in how much we have done to translate their roles from during the war to what they are today. Both from the military side and the LTT side, they struggle a lot with their new roles and responsibilities in everyday society.
The education process leaves out a lot of our history, which we should, again, to look forward, you need to look back, learn the lessons and move on, but it cannot happen the way it is. How do we change this, since it's never going to happen in an official capacity? How do we then change it in a way where education, this kind of education, becomes a priority?
So what I would encourage people involved in this work at a community level, at a national level, is to find non-traditional and innovative interventions to kind of do that. So for example, right now at the NCEASL, we are working on an intervention where we are about to launch a virtual museum addressing freedom of religion or belief in Sri Lanka, and looking at key events which are positive and negative, and even events where communities came together, so coexistence. Because like you said, Savitri, history, a lot of history is biased history that is being taught to the kids. So we need to be able to bring in that alternative narrative and that neutral narrative. So that is one of the things that we are hoping to do.
Swamalini, how do women actually get a seat at the table for peace and reconciliation?
We've seen, like, we've had two governments doing consultation, asking people how they want things to be done going forward from the conflict. But all those consultations where women have gone forward and made a lot of recommendations, you know, those reports, like many others, are just gathering dust somewhere. So definitely we need more women to bring more, actively look to bring those women representative of the various places in this country that have seen some of the brunt of the conflict, to bring them to the policy-making table.
Peace may seem an unattainable prospect, but if each of us works as a change agent, think of the difference we can make. Thank you to our peace prompters who appeared on Selinko Live. Let's talk.
With Selinko Life Pension Saver, Sri Lanka's premier retirement plan, start planning for your retirement today. Selinko Life, a relationship for life.